gospel. As the story goes, Jesus is teaching his disciples, and he says, "The Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him, and 3 days after being killed, he will rise again." Of course, the disciples fail to connect the dots that to follow Jesus may be a sacrificial and servant-oriented. For as they follow Jesus on the way, they argue with one another regarding who is the greatest. And Jesus says to them, "Whoever wants to be first must be last of all and servant of all." As one called to follow Jesus as a bishop, I'm mindful of an encounter I had at St. James Episcopal Church in Dalhart, Texas, up in the corner of the Panhandle. After Sunday services, I was walking through the Sunday school classrooms, and I had removed my mitre, of course, after the celebration of the Eucharist, and this beautiful 6-year-old girl looked up at me, and she saw this red line across my forehead from wearing my brand new tight-fitting mitre, and she said, "Does that crown hurt your head?" Now, that's interesting that when I tell that story, people, including bishops, tend to say, "Well, how sweet is that girl to be so concerned and compassionate toward her bishop," and it is sweet. Or maybe I'll get teased a little about wearing a crown of thorns, you know, bless my heart, something like that. But that's not the point in telling the story. It's what this little girl sees that gets my attention. She sees a crown along with a coat that would make Henry VIII proud. And the mitre, of course, is supposed to represent Pentecostal tongues of fire, the Holy Spirit. But I'm afraid people see a king or a queen. Of course, the bishop is not a king or queen. And furthermore, the church is not an empire. News may travel slowly, but those days are gone, praise God. The days had long passed since the church saw itself as an empire, as we have moved from the Reformation and the Enlightenment into this post-Constantinian, post-Christendom time, wondering now, what is next on the horizon? Everyone from theologians to historians to sociologists speculate on where the church is now in human history. Stanley Hauerwas and Will Willimon say that we're in a post-Constantinian age. Douglas John Hall says post-Christendom. Phyllis Tickle calls it the Great Emergence. And Diana Butler Bass and Brian McLaren are using the same language. Harvey Cox says we are moving from the age of belief, meaning belief systems, that we are moving from the age of belief to the age of the Spirit. And Houston Smith calls this the second revolution of the human spirit. Something's up, and I suspect you've heard some of this. Interestingly enough, none of these folks are saying this is bad. In one way or another, they are saying it is liberating. They see it as opportunity. I'm drawn personally to the way that Houston Smith frames this. Houston Smith, probably the expert on world religions, says that there have been two great revolutions of the human spirit. The first, he says, was disastrous, for it pushed the spirit to the margins. He points to the controlled experiment of the modern world as the beginning of this first revolution, the scientific method which demands empirical evidence for everything. Because evidence is needed to prove anything in this modern world, Absence of evidence becomes equated with evidence of absence. That's one consequence of the new scientific method. But there really is another. The modern scientific method separates and divides. Newtonian physics separated, divided, examined, weighed, and measured. The modern scientific worldview, along with modern philosophy, was the water in which we swam, and this convergence of factors led to a theology. which pushed John to someplace out there and divided the spiritual from the material, and the mind from the heart, and the human from the divine. And now, according to Smith, we enter this second great revolution of the human spirit. For postmodern science, the science of today, quantum science, particle science, string theory, all about which I know nothing, postmodern science does not ask the same questions. Interestingly enough, the new science observes what Eastern metaphysics has claimed all along, that all is one, that all is connected. The old science gave us the Industrial Revolution with its assembly lines and hierarchy, and the new science gives us the World Wide Web, and now even in business and politics, the world is flat. The old science would divide and separate. The new science, while making no claims about God, the new science looks for connections. So Houston Smith claims that we are now in this second revolution of the human spirit. And the new physics, the new philosophy, observes what our tradition has said from the beginning, that all is one, that all is connected. I don't know about you, but I see exciting possibilities as we proclaim the gospel in this new day, recovering and proclaiming the truth that God permeates creation, that we live and move and have our being in God. And it is a challenging time also. For if all is connected, as we claim, then it means more than just leisurely reading the mystics. If it's true that we are connected, then it's as if you hit your thumb with a hammer. The rest of your body does not say, the rest of us are okay, I'm sorry about that thumb. We don't wonder, do I have time for that thumb? Or do I have money for that thumb? Or that thumb has dirt under the thumbnail and it looks infected. The thumb is a member of the body and is struck by a hammer. There appears to be a sense of urgency to relieve the pain in that thumb. The new day calls for a servant church rather than a Christendom church, a cruciform church rather than an imperial church. Today's gospel, Jesus says, whoever wants to be first must be last of all and servant of all. Whoever would be great among you must be your servant. Even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve. So we could say that Jesus is giving his followers their marching orders to serve. And obviously there's truth to that. Jesus is teaching his disciples to become servants, and it appears that they are not naturals at servanthood. But evidently Jesus has hope for them. So maybe there's hope for me too. I know that as I look out among you, I am seeing people who serve sacrificially in and through this congregation and beyond. And as servants, as fellow servants, I wonder if you would agree with me that marching orders to serve are not very sustaining over the long haul and do not alone give us much fuel. And I wonder further if Jesus doesn't know that about our hearts. And I'm going to suggest that while Jesus travels with his chosen disciples on the road to Jerusalem, where he will make the ultimate sacrifice, that he seeks to teach them something more than just the outward behavior of servanthood. I'm suggesting that Jesus intends to convey something more than what we ought to do in response to a command to serve. It's true that on this road to Jerusalem, Jesus seeks to raise up servants, but no less than that, he is directing his followers to look into their hearts. What's going on inside as the disciples argue about who will go down as the greatest, or who will be somebody in the eyes of the world, or who will be famous. What's going on inside? I want to pause just for a moment to tell a story. Over 20 years ago, when we lived in Texarkana, Kathy and I liked to go down to Memphis, Tennessee, and stroll up and down the famous Beale Street, the home of several blues establishments. One day, as we were soaking up the ambiance, we came across several historical markers. I don't know if you've ever been there, and maybe you've seen these, but they are very colorfully written. Well, one of the markers in particular grabbed my attention enough that I had to write it down. And it's a quote from a band leader talking about one of his trumpet players, a man named Charlie Robinson. The band leader says of Robinson, "Charlie Robinson was one of my dream trumpet players. He never went up in the high C, never went way up the staff. Just stayed within two octaves. He could get into your heart. High notes meant nothing to him. He didn't need them." Charlie Robinson did not need to hit the high notes to be somebody. How rare in the world of trumpets, where hitting the high notes makes one famous. Rare enough that it's news. Rare enough that it makes its way onto a historical marker on Beale Street, Memphis, Tennessee. I guess we could say that the disciples in today's story want to hit the high notes somehow. To be seen as somebody in the eyes of the world. They don't realize that they were somebody before the journey began. For that matter, they were somebody before they were chosen, before they were called to follow Jesus. Another story, a very familiar story about Jesus himself, the story about his baptism in the river. The depiction above your font over here portrays Jesus by himself in the river with John the Baptist, and it is very evocative. But Mark's gospel, for example, tells us that all the people of Jerusalem were in the river confessing their sins and being baptized by John. And Luke paints the picture of a mass baptism as a multitude responds to John's call to repentance. And Jesus, who had no reason to repent, could have kept his distance and watched from the bank of the river, innocent of any reason to confess or repent. But instead of looking down upon the people from afar, Jesus stepped into the river with the crowd. Rather than claiming his innocence, Jesus chose to identify with the crowd. Jesus chose to be one of us, baptized in the same water, the same river. When Jesus steps into that river with the masses, steps into that river with us, he's telling us that we are accepted. Just as the voice from heaven proclaimed that Jesus was accepted before he began his public ministry, before he healed anyone, before he washed the feet of his disciples, before he suffered, before he went to the cross, before he accomplished one thing in his public ministry, Jesus was accepted. So too, you are accepted. Jesus comes up out of these waters of baptism, and the heavens part, and the dove descends, and the voice declares, "You are my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased," before Jesus accomplishes one thing. And those words are meant for you too. Before you serve, before you wash feet, before you obey, before you accomplish one thing, you are accepted, you are somebody. Once there was a dream trumpet player named Charlie Robinson. High notes meant nothing to him. He didn't need them. and neither do we need them, nor does anyone else need them to be somebody. You are loved and accepted already. Everyone is. And that is the gospel, the good news of God's love, which we are called to proclaim and embody. In the name of the Lord.